this was just a sound test.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome all visitors to Holy Family Parish. In today's gospel, we hear that Jesus wept. While our faith continually reminds us that Jesus is divine, that same faith tells us of the humanity of Jesus. He experienced all that we do, except sin. Thus, we have a compassionate Lord and friend who knows what we're going through. May we, as a faith community, weep with those who weep and laugh with those who laugh. With one voice, we now sing from the gather number 482, The Cross of Jesus.
Oh, yeah. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Good morning, everyone.
Amen.
As we hear in this weekend's gospel, Jesus weeps over the death of his friend Lazarus, and he weeps with his friends Martha and Mary. We know that Jesus has compassion for the suffering, for those who mourn. So too, Jesus mourns with us when we mourn our sin. As we turn to God, together then let us acknowledge these our sins and turn to him for the grace of his mercy and forgiveness. Lord Jesus, resurrection and life, you raised Lazarus from the dead. Kyrie eleison. Lord Jesus, resurrection and life, you are the Messiah, the Son of God. Christe eleison. Lord Jesus, resurrection and life, you are the way that leads to everlasting life. Kyrie eleison. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Let us pray. By your help, we beseech you, Lord our God, may we walk eagerly in that same charity with which, out of love for the world, your Son handed himself over to death. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, O my people, I will open your graves and have you rise from them and bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and have you rise from them, O my people. I will put my spirit in you that you may live, and I will settle you upon your land. Thus you shall know that I am the Lord. I have promised, and I will do it, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
The psalm is number 87 in the Gather Book.
Oh, A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, those who are in the flesh cannot please God, but you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit, if only the Spirit of God dwells in you. Whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit dwelling in you. The word of the Lord.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Now a man was ill, Lazarus from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who had anointed the Lord with perfumed oil and dried his feet with her hair. It was her brother Lazarus who was ill. So the sisters sent word to Jesus saying, "Master, the one you love is ill." When Jesus heard this, he said, "This illness is not to end in death, but is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was ill, he remained for 2 days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just trying to stone you, and you want to go back there?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in a day? If one walks during the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks at night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him." He said this and then told them, "Our friend Lazarus is asleep, but I am going to awaken him." So the disciples said to him, "Master, if he is asleep, he will be saved." But Jesus was talking about his death, while they thought that he meant ordinary sleep. So then Jesus said to them clearly, "Lazarus has died, and I am glad for you that I was not there, that you may believe. Let us go to him." So Thomas, called Didymus, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go to die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, only about 2 miles away. And many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary sat at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise." Martha said to him, "I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus told her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, Yes, Lord. I have come to believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world. When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary secretly, saying, The teacher is here and is asking for you. As soon as she heard this, she rose quickly and went to him. For Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still where Martha had met him. So when the Jews who were with her in the house comforting her saw Mary get up quickly and go out, they followed her, presuming that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her weeping, he became perturbed and deeply troubled and said, Where have you laid him? They said to him, Sir, come and see. And Jesus wept. So the Jews said, See how he loved him? But some of them said, Could not the one who opened the eyes of the blind man have done something so that this man would not have died? So Jesus, perturbed again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay across it. Jesus said, Take away the stone. Martha, the dead man's sister, said to him, Lord, by now there will be a stench, for he has been dead for 4 days. Jesus said to her, Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And Jesus raised his eyes and said, Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me. But because of the crowd here, I have said this, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, he cried out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, tied hand and foot with burial bands, and his face was wrapped in a cloth. So Jesus said to them, Untie him and let him go. And many of the Jews who had come to Mary and seen what he had done began to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord. Throughout the past couple of months, as we've been going through the work of reaching our goal for the bishop's appeal, I've been giving weekly updates through our billboard sign or through our digital display board out there in the narthex, and many of you know that we were very, very close to our goal last weekend. We were at 90%, and my thought was, as we were that close, I thought, wouldn't it be cool if we could be at 100% when Bishop Ricken showed up here for our Rural Life Mass this past Thursday? So then every Tuesday morning is when Brandon and I in the office, we get the weekly email from the diocese that gives us the information on how we are doing on our bishop's appeal goal. And so Tuesday morning came and we saw the numbers and we got super excited, but the math showed that we were at 98%. And I thought, oh, we got so close. But I thought, wait, I'm going to call the diocese and ask them if Thursday morning when we have the bishop here for the Rural Life Mass, if they can call me and let me know if anything came in throughout the week, maybe we could get to our goal. Wednesday came and went. Thursday morning came. It was about 9:30 in the morning, I think was about the time. And Josh from the diocese called and said, You guys are so close, but you're $300 short. And he said, Don't worry about it. You're this close. You're going to get it in no time. And this is already way ahead of schedule. But it was a good effort. But, you know, it's not a big deal to not get it before the bishop's there for the Mass. We agreed. And so there was a little bit of disappointment. About 10 minutes later, Josh called back and said, Wait. There was one in the queue on the internet given that somebody had given online and we hadn't counted that. You guys are now past your goal. So we are at 100% of our goal as a parish. So that is wonderful, wonderful news. So the bishop was very excited to hear that. We got to announce it at the Rural Life Mass. And just on behalf of Bishop and the entire diocese, I want to express my thanks to all of you for your great sacrifices that you make to be able to reach our goal. And to be able to reach this goal so quickly is unthinkable. I mean, we weren't even at April 1st when we reached our goal, and generally it's by the end of June is when we're finishing up our bishop's appeal. So I want to thank you for your generosity and ask for your continued stewardship to our parish. Many of you have looked at your bulletin You know that weekly by weekly, our number that we're off from our budget is growing, so we continue to need your stewardship, your care of your gifts to be able to help us continue the mission of the church. But again, for our Bishop's Appeal Goal, I want to express my deep gratitude to you for your many sacrifices that you've made. Now is the time, now that we've reached our goal, in which we turn our attention and our efforts to praying for those who will be the recipients of what we have contributed. Those people that we saw in the video that recognize their need that they have for the church to help them in moments of crisis, whether it's the loss of a loved one, whether it's a recent change in their family dynamics, separation, divorce, whether it's someone who's having financial difficulty, or even as we continue the life of the parish ministry, and we know that we've always pinpointed, so many of our parish ministries are impacted by the work of the Bishop's Appeal. Now is the time for us to pray that what our gifts have been offered may be fruitful in the lives of those that they have touched. Oftentimes we give of our gifts to a certain contribution, we just forget about it. We just assume that somebody else is taking care of it, and while we know we're contributing to a good thing, we forget about the lives that are touched in those regards. This weekend's gospel gives us a very important time for us to pause and to be able to reflect upon the humanness of everything that we do, the person-to-person interaction that we have. We've heard from John's gospel for the last 3 weekends now. Last weekend we heard of Jesus healing a blind man. The weekend before we hear Jesus offering the mercy to the woman at the pool of Siloam. And what we hear from each of these accounts of John's gospel is a very personal side of Jesus. A person who has emotion. A person who cares about another soul. And while we may hear today's gospel reading and it becomes somewhat sanitized by reading it from a book and being able to proclaim it as a gospel, we can imagine all the emotion that went into today's reading. We can imagine the emotion of Martha and Mary as they call out to Jesus to let them know that his friend Lazarus is sick, and we have that sense of a hint in their hearts that perhaps he'll come and heal him so that he won't have to die. We hear the disappointment and perhaps the anger that they had towards Jesus when he does arrive and they tell him, had you been here, our brother would not have died. And how many of us can feel that same effect in our own lives when we pray for a loved one to get better, when we pray for healing, and yet they still pass on to eternal life, and we have that same anger. We have that same disconnection with God. Why wasn't God listening to my prayers? Doesn't he care about me? We can imagine the emotion of Jesus. We hear in the shortest passage from all of Scripture, now, when John wrote his gospel, he didn't write it in chapters and verses. That came much, much later as the Bible was developed. But the people who did divide the Bible into chapters and verses chose just two small words, the shortest verse in all of Scripture. Jesus wept. Perhaps it's to pinpoint or to highlight the very care, the very compassion, the very human nature of who Jesus is as he mourns with and for each and every one of us in our own lives. And so while it says Jesus wept, we know that Lazarus was a good friend of his. So were Martha and Mary. It tells us at the beginning of the scripture that Jesus loved them all. These were special people in Jesus' life. To Martha and Mary, to their brother Lazarus, Jesus wasn't just the Son of God, wasn't just the Messiah, although they understood that. But to them, Jesus was more. He was a friend. He was a brother. And so there's a very intimate connection, and we can imagine that it wasn't that just that Jesus wept, but we can imagine Jesus crying throughout the entire scene as we would mourn and weep over the loss of a loved one. Of course, we go through stages where grief is harder and more difficult. Jesus would have went through those same things. And so it's somewhat sanitized for us to hear that today. And yet if we're to reflect upon just those two little words, Jesus wept, for what does he weep? Of course, he's lost a friend. He has lost his brother Lazarus, and he is moved with great compassion and sorrow over the loss of a friend, albeit he knows that he can raise him from the dead. Perhaps he also weeps because he sees the pain and the anguish that are in the hearts of Martha and Mary. How many of us, at times we can be reading through the newspaper, or we hear a news article on the television, and we hear the story of another tragic accident, we hear another story of a shooting victim. Perhaps we're reading through the obituary section and we're reading through and we see the long list of names, and to us they're just names. Perhaps we read for a little bit of detail out of curiosity more so. And then suddenly as we're reading, we come across the family who have been left behind, and suddenly we see maybe somebody that we know from work, or somebody that is from among our community, and we say, oh, that was so-and-so's brother, or so-and-so's sister. And suddenly we have at least a personal connection with the person that we're reading about or hearing about. How much more of a connection is there in our heart when we actually know the person that we're reading about, when it's our own family member or our own coworker that we're reading their obituary? And so Jesus has this personal connection. And so he weeps not only with Martha and Mary, but he weeps for them. But perhaps there's another element to this. It lies within Jesus' question that he asks Martha. I am the resurrection and the life. I can raise your brother from the dead, not only at the end of time, but in the here and the now. And there's the question that he asks of Martha, that he asks of each and every one of us who profess our faith in him. Do you believe this? If we truly believe it, it is a message that we too, like Martha and Mary, are called to proclaim from the depths of our hearts, from the wetness of our tears, that indeed, truly, Jesus is the Son of God. He's my Savior. He's my brother. And so if we truly feel this message, it's a message that we should feel compelled to draw others to. It's the life of discipleship. One particular way that we invite you to do that is to, and I'm going to ask you to look to the end of your pews. You should see little brochures or little bookmarks there. And I want each family to take one. And stewardship has been working on this little thing for probably over about a year now. And it's coming to fruition. What we're going to do is take one specific weekend, June 3rd and 4th. Now you think June 3rd and 4th, well, that's a couple months away. That was the same thing I was thinking about tax day a couple months ago. That's still a long ways away. Now it's coming. But June 3rd and 4th, we're asking you to think about it now because we want you to prayerfully discern if there's a person in my life that I know that I could really reach out to and I could share with them the gift of my faith. And I could share with them not only that I come to Mass because it's a reward for everything I've done right, but it's because I need to be here because I need the medicine that is God's mercy for me. I need what Jesus has come to bring into my life, and I need that on a regular basis. And to think about people in my life that maybe I could invite to the celebration of the Mass. And so we're going to offer that June 3rd and 4th Mass. It's going to be a special weekend in which we invite other people, people that we invite to celebrate the sacred mysteries with us. And so we ask you to prayerfully discern, who is that person? Is it a family member? Is it a neighbor? Is it a coworker? Somebody in my life that perhaps I know they already have faith, or maybe their faith could be stronger. And to prayerfully discern that and to tear off that bottom little part and to invite them to our celebration of the Mass and to keep that so that they can keep that bottom part perhaps on their refrigerator or as a bookmark of their own so that they remember which weekend they'll come. Of course, it's the first weekend of the month, so they're going to love our Donut Sundays, but we're going to even have more than that. We're going to have a special little social afterwards so that people can get to know them and that they can get connected to the rest of the community. But we're making a special effort to share the message, to share the gift of what we've been given. But there's a second aspect to this weekend's reading as well. And it's the aspect of what Martha and Mary and Lazarus experienced in their life was Jesus as a personal friend, a personal brother that they experienced in their own life. We're about to embark upon the most sacred weeks of our entire faith. Next weekend we celebrate Palm Sunday, which honors the day that Jesus marched into Jerusalem and all the crowds welcomed him by laying down palms. And we'll hear the entire Passion narrative proclaimed for us. And we'll remember the story. Then on Holy Thursday, Good Friday, we'll celebrate Jesus' Passion and his death. And at the Easter Vigil and on Easter Sunday, we'll celebrate his glorious resurrection from the dead. And once again, we'll remember the story that has been proclaimed to us. But as we journey throughout these days, I implore you, as John's Gospel relates to us, as we hear the compassion of Jesus, to remember this. That they're not just words written on a piece of paper, and not a bunch of pieces of paper put together in a book called the Scripture. These are the stories. This is the life story of the Savior who has come to redeem us, who has come to save us, of the Son of God, of the Messiah, of your brother, of your friend. Do you believe this? May God bless you. Together we profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate to the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Together let us cry out to the Lord of the let us cry to the Lord out of the depths, for we trust in the Lord and in God's word.
Our response to the petition would be the following.
For the Holy Church of God, as we proclaim life to a world weighed down by death and despair.
We pray to the Lord, God of mercy, hear our prayer.
That nations of the world set aside weapons of death and destruction and embrace life and reconciliation.
We pray to the Lord.
For those who suffer the death of discrimination and oppression, that they might know encouragement and life.
We pray to the Lord, God of mercy, hear our prayer.
That our community of faith might bring our neighbors to new life by our actions of justice and love, just as spring brings the world of nature back to life.
We pray to the Lord, God of mercy, hear our prayer.
For George Hsu, for whom this Mass is being celebrated, and for all the intentions that remain in our hearts and those listed in our petition book.
We pray to the Lord, God of mercy, hear our prayer.
O God of life, with you is kindness and plentiful redemption. Graciously hear and answer these our prayers, which we now make in the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
As our gifts of wine and bread are presented, we will sing from the gather number 945, I Am the Bread of Life.
I am.
pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. For the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Hear us, Almighty God, and having instilled in your servants the teachings of the Christian faith, graciously purify them by the working of this sacrifice. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as true man he wept for Lazarus his friend, and as eternal God raised him from the tomb. Just as, taking pity on the human race, he leads us by sacred mysteries to new life. Through him, the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. Almighty Father, we bless through Jesus Christ, your Son, who comes in your name. He himself is the word that brings salvation, the hand you extend to sinners, the way by which your peace is offered to us. When we ourselves had turned away from you on account of our sins, you brought us back to be reconciled, O Lord, so that converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation Christ has brought us, we entreat you, sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. For when about to give his life to set us free, as he reclined at supper, he himself took bread into his hands. In giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing your mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Celebrating, therefore, the memorial of the death and resurrection of your Son, who left us this pledge of his love, we offer you what you have bestowed on us, the sacrifice of perfect reconciliation. Holy Father, we humbly beseech you to accept us also, together with your Son, and in this saving banquet graciously to endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from one another. May he make your church a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace among all people. And may he keep us in communion with Francis our Pope and David our Bishop and all the bishops and your entire people. Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together with the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and all the saints, with our brothers and sisters, and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will shine forth in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Let us pray with confidence in the words that our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And
let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Please join in singing our communion song, number 944 in the Gather, in remembrance of you, number 944.
Thank you.
Please join in singing Mercy, O God. It is found in the Gather Book, number 480. 480.
This time we call forth from among our community those who will take communion to our homebound, our family and friends who cannot be with us in our celebration of the Mass. Let us pray. As you go to the sick and to the homebound, take with you not only the sacrament we have celebrated, but also the word of God which we have heard proclaimed, as well as the prayers and the affection of this parish community. Ask for the prayers of those whom you visit in return. Go now, we pray, in God's peace and blessing. Amen. This weekend being the first weekend in our month of April, we have our second collection to benefit our capital improvement campaign. So at this time, our ushers will be distributing the collection plates for our capital improvement campaign. And as they're doing so, I'm going to keep talking. I'm going to talk about some of the things that we are working on in terms of the use of your capital improvement funds. There's a few items that have been highlighted or pinpointed by our Buildings and Grounds Committee as we've gone through the long-range planning process, and a few things that I want to make you aware of. The first, one of the biggest ones that you'll see happening here at the church, probably in the next number of months as we go forward, will be the replacement of the sidewalk in the immediate front of the church entry. You know that every winter we tend to get more and more buckling as the ground freezes and then it thaws, and so sometimes it can raise anywhere from a quarter of an inch to an inch between each of those sheets of block out there in terms of our sidewalk. So we'll be replacing all the sidewalk from the handicapped entryway on that side to the handicapped entryway on that side, where the little dip in the sidewalk is to allow people on access to the sidewalk. Underneath the sidewalk, they're planning on putting in new gravel and different things like that, but they're also planning on putting on a couple sheets of, now I drew blank on what I was gonna say, something like styrofoam that will be able to give as the ground expands and detracts, so it'll be able to keep our sidewalks much more level. So that's one important safety measure that's being taken here at the parish, one important item that's being used with capital improvement funds. There are a couple things that you may not see. Well, actually, there's another one that you'll probably see in the near future, more work on our parking lot. Of course, we have little areas that continue to break up each and every winter, so we continue to fix those. There's a few things that you probably won't see, but are still happening. Number one is to work on the drainage of the water away from the building, which I talked about last fall, but we didn't have a chance to do it before the snow fell. So more tiling that'll be done to draw water away from the church so it doesn't pool up outside. And the second one will be to recoat the outside brick of the church so that it repels water better. That way that'll draw water away from the top of the roof. So we have a lot of issues with water around here at the church, so we'll be dealing with a lot of those things. Another one that's going to be coming down the pipeline is, and this one we have to get your approval for. I'm not going to do a vote, like raise your hands. I will ask if you're opposed, please tell me on your way out of church or give me your information somehow. I won't have you raise your hand if you're opposed because I don't want everybody looking at you and you might feel out of place or whatever. But one of the things that we've been noticing here at the church is that as generations continue to grow among our parish community, perhaps there's different times where it'd be a little bit better to have stability coming into and out of the sanctuary space. And so this especially applies to Eucharistic ministers, to lectors, but it also applies to when we have senior priests come in and help celebrate the Mass. So I know originally when they built the church, somebody told me last night, they did not put in railings because they didn't think it would be aesthetically very good. But we think that there's a practical reason that they need to be in here. So we're looking at putting in railings that would go up that side, that corner right over there, and on the far corner right over there, there would be wooden railings that would match our altar and also our ambo. Tony and Sue Schmidt are working on those already. To make the woodworking as close as possible and look as aesthetically pleasing as possible. There'll be railings on each side, so you can come up from either side, depending on some people need help on their right or some on their left. And so that's one thing that I need your input on. If you're opposed to it, or if you want to offer your feedback, if you're in favor of it, you can let me know as you're shaking hands on the way out of church, or you can send me an email or call me here at the church, just to let me know. But the diocese does require that we have parishioner approval before we apply for a proxy to make any kind of a change to our worship space. The second worship space change that we continue to look into, although I don't have any numbers for you, and I'm not asking for a vote on this one yet, but we have looked into LED lighting here in the church and also in the narthex. We continue to burn through ballasts much quicker than we're supposed to. The lights are very hard to change because they're directly above the seating area. We're looking into LED lighting because basically the LED lighting lasts a long, long time before it has to be replaced. Plus, it's much more energy efficient. So while there's a big upfront cost to put in LED lighting, in the long term, perhaps they help us beneficially. So we're still looking into that. We need more assurances of what it's going to look like in here. We know that LED lighting at times can be harsh. Sometimes it's too dull. And we just need some assurances from our vendors as to what we'd be getting for our price tag. So we continue to look into that. But just so that you're aware, where does our second collection for capital improvements go? Those are some of the projects that we're currently working on. As this is also Wedding Blessing Weekend, we invite anyone with an April waiting the anniversary to please rise as we offer God's blessing upon you this morning. All kinds of them in April. Tis the season. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you have so exalted the unbreakable bond of marriage that it has become the sacramental sign of your Son's union with the Church as his spouse. Look with favor this day and all days upon our brothers and sisters whom you have united in marriage as they ask for your help and the protection of the Virgin Mary. They pray that in good times and in bad they will grow in love for each other and that they will resolve to be of one heart in the bond of peace. Lord, in their struggles, let them rejoice that you are near to help them. In their needs, let them know that you are there to rescue them. And in their joys, let them see that you are the source and the completion of every happiness. Loving Father, we ask you to send your blessings on our brothers and sisters among us who have lost their spouses. As they remember their anniversaries this month, may the memories of their loved ones bring them comfort, peace, and joy. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Congratulations to all of you. With a week of and let us pray. We pray, Almighty God, that we may always be counted among the members of Christ, in whose body and blood we have communion, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
This Wednesday, April 5th, is our Lenten Reconciliation Service at 6 p.m. There will be 5 priests available for confessions. We are in need of ministers for our Holy Week Masses. Sign-up sheets are in the volunteer table. On Palm Sunday, April 9th, the Estovir Men's Group will be sponsoring our Rosary Prayer Service at 3 p.m. in church with a social following. Everyone is welcome to attend. Bring your family, friends, and neighbors. Let's start Holy Week in a special way. Invite a friend or relative to Mass event is set for June 3rd and 4th at all the Masses. A social gathering is to follow Mass that weekend.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
I invite you to bow your heads as we pray for God's blessing. Bless, O Lord, your people who long for the gift of your mercy, and grant that what, at your prompting, they desire, they may receive by your generous gift, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God. We go forth with renewed strength, singing from the gather number 479, Lord, who throughout these 40 days.
Thank you. Amen.